We are going to talk about palliative care in non-oncological illness. This is as important as we discuss palliative care in cancer, but usually palliative care has been seen synonymous with cancer palliative care, because in most of the centers, palliative care is limited to cancer. But nowadays we see that other chronic illnesses have equal or even more palliative care need, because many of these diseases patients live for very long time. They have very poor quality of life, and many times their symptoms are uncontrolled. There is the lack of communications and other psychosocial issues. So we will, in next 30 minutes, we will try to understand a little bit about different chronic illness. Before starting about particular diseases, we'll talk about what is palliative care. So you already know by this time, now, that palliative care is an active holistic approach to improve the quality of life of people who are suffering from various illnesses or some other serious health related sufferings are there. It is for patients of all ages and can be due to any disease. And it is not limited only to the patients, it may be for the family members or other caregivers. And it focuses both on the disease as well as on the comfort of the patients, and mainly focused on the comfort. That include the physical comfort, psychosocial comfort, and spiritual support for the patients. Okay, so how it is different from other illnesses? How the palliative care in cancer and palliative care in non-oncological diseases is different? So it can be in lung diseases like COPD, heart diseases like end-stage heart failure, chronic kidney diseases, and neurological disease. We see a lot of patients who require palliative care. In some of infective diseases, especially HIV, multi-drug resistance tuberculosis, or patients with post-TB sequelae, they may need palliative care. And especially in ICU or emergencies, we see patients with life-threatening infections or multi-drug resistant infections, ventilator acquired pneumonias and all. So there are, these are the patients who may need palliative care. But the question comes, how is it different? So can anyone tell if you had seen any patients and you think that patients may need palliative care? If anyone of you can tell, or if you know about any patient whom you think the palliative care need was there?
Anybody, all of you are seeing many type of patients, and you should have come across such a patient. So anybody can share your experience.
Okay, and I'm sure all of you must have seen patients with stroke. Patients with stroke, especially who are in poor neurological status and decreased awareness with the surroundings and all. Maybe patients with dementia. If I get some response, it will be more interactive and it will be more interesting for me to discuss.
Hi, so I'm Jenna. So generally, my patients will have dementia. So generally, I handle senior patients. So I think mostly I handle non-cancer, and they have dementia mostly. Okay. And palliative care, yeah.
Okay, okay. So you had seen patients with cancer and they had dementia.
No, not cancer, but okay. They're just dementia, yeah.
Dementia, just... okay, okay. So what are the problems you feel like? What are the things that these patients suffer from? What are their main concerns of these patients?
Generally, towards the end, my patient will actually refuse to eat. And I always tell them that it will be best if they actually early on have a tube. But when it's towards the real, real end, that's actually when we don't feed. But like closer to the end, I still want them to have hydration. So generally, they will refuse to feed. Generally, I will get a lot of aspiration pneumonia cause for them to be critical. That's I think mostly the stroke with the dementia that I handle. Let me see. I think yes, those are the things that I mostly encounter.
Pankaj, you are muted.
Pankaj, sir?
I'm sorry, there was a power cut and I got disconnected. Okay, I think I need to share my slide again. Sorry for the interruption.
Pneumonia, if forced, or even without forcing them to. So mostly they also develop pneumonia.
Yes. So one thing there is many times because of their neurological illness, they may not perform the routine activities. Nutrition is activity of daily living. They may not be able to do that. Other thing is they may develop some of the complication of the disease. Okay. So in patients, there are chances of aspiration pneumonia. Okay. Yes, that's correct. That is very, very commonly we see these concerns. Okay. So in neurological disease, there is a few things there are diverse symptoms. With each disease, there may be some specific symptoms related to that disease, or maybe some common symptoms that may be there. And with each illness, those symptoms may be different. So we need to know something about the general palliative care approach and specific palliative care approach for those illness. Okay. Other thing that makes it more complex, non-oncological palliative care is that we don't exactly know what is the prognosis of patient, what will happen to the patient and how long he got. So to understand this thing in bit more detail, we'll go to the next slide. So this, we discuss about the trajectory of illness. This graph shows the trajectory of usually in the cancer illness. So for most of the time, patients with cancer, especially when they are diagnosed with earlier stage, they have quite preserved function till the very end, maybe for last few months to last few years, they have very preserved function. But when it comes to the metastatic disease or terminal cancer, their quality of life, suddenly it falls until the death. Okay, but this may not be so simple in other illnesses. When we talk about organ failure or organ diseases, the trajectory is different. Okay, so these patients, their functionality, their activities of daily living, slowly it may deteriorate, and there in between there may be some episode where there will be sudden drop in their functionality. So in your case, what you discussed, like patients with dementia, they may develop the aspiration pneumonia. But with the infection or with some aggressive treatment, that functionality may again come up. Okay. Although dementia has the third trajectory, if we talk about patients with chronic kidney diseases, okay. So sometimes they develop acute exacerbation of breathlessness because of pulmonary edema, but with the dialysis or with some support, they may improve almost to the near normal how the patients was before. But at that point of time, at the point of crisis, we don't know whether the patients will actually come out or not. So it is very uncertain in these patients to give a prognosis. So I usually see a lot of patients with chronic kidney diseases because I see that specialty here. And many times when I see some patient in ICU or who is very ill, I ask my nephrologist, what do you think, how much he will live for? So he says he may not know. I don't know whether he will come out of this thing. If he comes out, maybe another 4 or 5 years. But after a week and after some time, we see that patient is no more. Okay, so it is very, very difficult in these patients. And after each crisis, there is some decline in their patient's condition. Okay, so this is trajectory 2. And trajectory 3, what Dr. Jaina was talking about, is for the frailty or dementia. So these patients who are very elderly, or patients with dementia, patients with advanced stroke, their functionality is low from the beginning, and slowly over the time, their functional capacity decreases over the time, and it is a more smooth curve. Okay, but again, it can be for very long time. Okay, for till now, does anyone want to ask or want to clarify this thing? Because this is one of the important concept of palliative care in non-oncological illness, understanding the trajectory, especially the second trajectory. Okay, so I will go to next thing. So what are the non-cancer illnesses that we talked about? So in heart diseases, it can be a symptomatic heart failure or end-stage heart failure. Patient with intractable angina pectoris, and that may leading to heart failure. And those patients who are treated with diuretics and vasodilators, and still their symptoms are uncontrolled. In pulmonary diseases, we see a lot of interstitial lung diseases in patients who have chronic dyspnea syndrome. Patients with end-stage COPD, very common disease in our setups, and we see a lot of patients, they suffer, and they are either oxygen-bound, they are on long-term oxygen, and they have a lot of palliative care need. Dementia is itself a very vast topic to discuss about the needs of palliative care, and among non-cancer illness, it is one of the major area where you see a role of palliative care. HIV, initially when it was we saw HIV in 90s or early 2000, when ARTs, good ARTs were not available, there was a huge role of palliative care because that time it was considered as life-threatening disease. But now with advanced ART, people live for a very long time, and now the need of palliative care need has completely changed. Okay, that we will discuss about in HIV patients. Then liver diseases, we see a lot of patients with alcoholic liver diseases or even non-alcoholic liver diseases. And because their quality of life is very poor or their life expectancy is poor, they have palliative care need. CKD patients, with those who are on dialysis or who are not on dialysis, they have terrible symptoms, a lot of comorbidities, and very high symptom burden in these patients. Patients with acute stroke or those who are on coma, they need long-term care. Many times they are in ICUs for very a long time, and discussing about goals of care in these patients, they definitely require good palliative care support. And it may be acute in the acute condition or chronic after stroke that we see with the rehabilitation team. Okay. So this is a gold standard framework that was devised to identify these patients who may need palliative care. So there is a proper checklist how we can identify these patients. So there are mainly three steps. One is identify whom, those patients who may be in their last year of their life. It may be last year, last month, or some last days of their life, and identify their needs and accordingly plan their treatment. Then once we have identified, assess their current needs and what can be anticipated for these patients, and then plan for their current symptoms and for the future so that they have a good end of life care. So this is three step gold standard framework that was devised from UK. Okay, so in this, how we can identify the patient. So first step in identify is asking the surprise question. So we usually ask the primary physician who is seeing the patients for some time, so or who is expert in such kind of illness, that would you be surprised if the patient were to die in next 1 month, next year, next month, or few days. If he says no, I won't be surprised, I expect that this patients may die in next 1 year, then that patient is that patient needs palliative care. Okay, if he says that I don't know, then we can give some general indicator of decline. Okay, so there are some general indicators. I think I have it. Yeah, so these are some of the general indicators of decline or increasing needs. So that is, the patient has increasing dependence, repeated unplanned admission, hospital admissions, advanced disease, and that is unstable, or it is deteriorating day by day, or there are complex symptom burden in that disease. Presence of significant multiple comorbidities like uncontrolled diabetes, there are multiple infections happening, or there are any ulcerations, bed sores, and all are there. If the patient's activity is reducing, like if we see on Karnofsky scale, if it is less than 60, or on Barthel scale, the patient is not able to do self-care, or patient is most of the time on the bed, then these patients have the need of palliative care. Decreasing response to the treatment are failing, like patients on CKD, they are not doing well on dialysis, they have repeated hypotensions or other complications of dialysis. Or the most important, the patient choice that he doesn't want any active treatment, and he want to focus on quality of life or good end of life care. And there are some other criteria also, maybe that progressive weight loss, some sentinel serious event. And one biochemical criteria is the albumin less than 2.5 is also a poor indicator of most of the disease. Then comes, if you are not sure that you have some indicator of general decline, then there may be some disease specific clinical indicator that depends on particular disease. So if you go to this website of Gold Standard Framework, you will see all those criteria for specific diseases. Okay. So once we identify, then comes how will you provide the palliative care. So I will go system wise. First I will go to renal palliative care. Until now, does anyone wants to clarify anything? If you have any questions, please put it on in the chat box, or you can also unmute yourself. Is it okay the way I am going, or is it too fast? Okay, I hope you are listening to me and you are with me. Okay, I'm talking now about the renal palliative care, or palliative care in kidney diseases. So recently I had seen one 71-year-old gentleman. He was a businessman before. Now he is not doing any work. He was diabetic, hypertensive. He had interstitial heart disease for which he underwent stenting. And he had CKD around 16 years back, and now he is on dialysis for last 4 years. For some gangrene in left lower limb, he had below knee amputation, and he is now complaining of some tingling sensation in right feet, that is severe. Chronic backache, he is complaining, that causes him that he is not able to sleep and lack of appetite. Recently, he came to ED with a weakness in right side. Right side of the body, and he was an altered sensorium. So we got a consultation to discuss about the goals of care of this patient. So this patient I kept because it shows the need of palliative care in this patient. So one thing and that you can see, there are multiple comorbidities associated with in these patients, and especially in CKD patients. They have number of symptoms. If you see at, on an average 4 to 5 symptoms they have. So I did some survey in our patients who are on dialysis, and I found almost 50% of the people had some moderate to severe symptoms for them, and that was not addressed. Okay, that signifies that there is a lot of palliative care need in these patients. And then comes the events. So this patient, he got a stroke, and he brought in poor consciousness. Okay, so in that time, how we should go? So talking about the goals of care, advanced care planning in these patients, or should we go aggressively, or should we go conservatively? These are a few challenges in palliative care. So as I told you, even in, if we see the survival wise, and the survival also in of the patients who are on dialysis dependent is not very, very good. It is almost equal to most of the cancers. Okay. So many times they ask, these patients of CKD, is dialysis is absolutely essential for these patients? Okay. So I ask them, in what sense? They ask, will I live longer if I start on dialysis, and will my symptoms actually improve if I start on dialysis? Okay, so in most of the patient, my answer is yes, you will live longer and you will have better symptom, better quality of life if you get the dialysis. But in some patients, like those who have multiple comorbidities, especially uncontrolled comorbidities, age more than 75, and whose performance status is very poor, those patients, it has been found that there has not been a significant improvement in length of survival, that is overall survival, and also in symptoms. So even patients in dialysis group, they found to have decreased physical functioning, decreased physical role. Their bodily pain increased, and they perceived that their health is deteriorating over the time. Okay, and other roles like social role, emotional role, and mental health was also worsening. While in the patients who were receiving renal care, their body pain, it was, I will not say improved, but almost the same. And their health perception and the mental health was almost the same. So it's not necessary, in especially in few patients who have poor performance status, that they will improve with the dialysis, and we can offer them a comfort care also. Okay, so if you want to read more about kidney diseases, you can go to one of the very important document, that is KDIGO controversies conference document on supportive care in kidney. You can get it easily online, or if you want, I can share this with my PPT. So it has given systematically what all challenges are there in goals of care, how you should initiate goals of care discussion, how you should control the symptoms in these patients, and how on those patients, if they want to decide whether to go on the dialysis or not, how you can do those discussion. Okay. Some patients, they want withdrawal from the dialysis. So when is the right time to initiate withdrawal from the dialysis? And the CKD is a bit a different illness. Okay, how? Because these patients, many times they feel like it's only the kidney that is involved. But it is not the kidney, it's a full system. They will have anemia, recurrent anemia, they will have recurrent infections. These patients are more prone for stroke or thromboembolic event. They have severe fatigue, appetite. Okay. And the problem is, once you have started on dialysis, it is perceived like they need to be on dialysis till the very last moment of the time. But if we see that this patient is deteriorating gradually, we can initiate the withdrawal from the dialysis. So there are guidelines how we can decide along with the nephrologist and the patient and their family members about withdrawal from the dialysis. Okay. So this clinical guideline gives you good idea about that. So who are the patients whom you can consider for withdrawal from the dialysis? These are the patients who have very limited estimated prognosis. But as I said, it is very difficult to estimate the prognosis. Those who have a poor quality of life, poor performance status, or those patients who have a very uncontrolled pain that is not responding to the treatment. Other progressive disease like cancer, dementia, peripheral vascular disease, congestive heart failure. So today only I saw one patient with dementia. She was 67-year-old female. But because it was recently they got to know about the dementia, and the family was very distressed with that. So they could not decide on whether to continue for the dialysis or not to. Or to withdrawal. So one advice what we can give is to give the time limited trial of the dialysis. They can see for few days, few months on the dialysis, and if she is able to undergo the dialysis, they can continue. Otherwise, to stop. Then other criteria is, are they able or are they unable or unwilling to do further dialysis? So a few days back, we saw one actually physician, very elderly physician, and he said, I am 77-year-old and I know I got CKD and I need dialysis, but it's my choice. I don't want to come to hospital every second day and go through those painful procedures. I have lived enough, and as long as I'm okay, I can continue for the medications. If medication doesn't work, it's better if I die peacefully in these patients. Okay, so we need to respect their decision also. Okay, then other criteria, dialysis is technically difficult or impossible, that occurs in a lot of chronic fistula failure patients or those patients who have a hypotension and all. To discuss goals of care, so these are some of the criteria. Then comes the next is to discuss the goals of care. So goals of care with the patient, if patient is available, otherwise and the family members. Discuss about the quality of life of the patients on the dialysis and off the dialysis. give them good symptom control. Once they have good symptom control, they will develop that confidence that they can live comfortably without dialysis also. And clarify that dialysis withdrawal is an option, and we will respect that thing. We reassure them that he can have a peaceful death, and that with the medications, at least the good end of life care can be provided. Okay, allow them to discuss among themselves with the siblings, with the children, with the parents, and to talk about this thing. Make recommendation to withdraw dialysis along with nephrologist, and request for the family's consent on that, and provide assurance. So this again for the doctor that I was talking about, his son was asking, if I sign this my advanced care plan document, then is it like I cannot reverse my decision? So I assured him that no, you can reverse your decision if you feel that your father will improve, his quality of life will improve with some time-limited trial of dialysis. You can consider for those things. So provide them that that assurance. Okay. For pain, if we discuss about the pain, most of our concepts are same. Only some medications we should avoid. So if it is a patient with advanced CKD who doesn't have any urine output, even you can consider for NSAIDs. Otherwise, NSAIDs are should not be given in other CKD patients. We can prefer paracetamol up to 4 grams per day. In step two, we can give low dose of weak opioids, that is tramadol or tapentadol, up to 100 mg per day. We can safely give even in patients of dialysis. But our preferred drug of choice in patients with moderate to severe pain will be fentanyl. So it can be either IV fentanyl or transdermal fentanyl. Similarly, other adjuvant analgesics can be given like gabapentin or pregabalin, but it need to be given in smaller doses. Okay. So then I will not go in detail about palliative care in HIV. But a simple concept. So we see a few patients here for those who have HIV, and if they have, especially if they have some uncontrolled symptoms. So we did few years back, we did some study about need of palliative care, and it was seen among, we did it for 98 patients, and almost 60 to 65 people, they said that they need palliative care for some symptoms or for some psychological symptoms. Okay. So how do identify these patients? So there is some criteria for certifying HIV as terminal illness. So if it is CD4 count is very, very low, or viral count is very high, or if they are having any other life-limiting illness, and and if it is supported by prolonged diarrhea, less albumin, or active substance abuse, advanced stage, not using ARTs, or dementia patients with heart failure or liver disease. These are some of the criteria for certifying it as terminal illness. In these patients, performance status should be less than 50%. So, and those approaches are again similar, that it's the clinical care or physical care along with psychological, spiritual, and social support for these patients. So physical symptoms here are maybe because of poor adherence to the medications, that can also cause the diminished quality of life. It leads to patients' demoralization, and they may not continue the treatment, and it will lead to more complications. They may not come to the physicians or infectious disease specialist because their symptoms are not getting controlled. So it is important to address their physical symptoms also. Other than that, there may be associated stigma we see, and a lot of time there. Caregivers are also deceased, and they have their own need. So these are some of issues in HIV. I will go to some symptoms here. So fatigue, very common symptoms here that may be idiopathic or maybe because of some infections, persistent anemia or hypogonadism. And there are two approaches. One is a specific treatment, that is treating the infections, treating the HIV, giving erythropoietin transfusion, erythropoietin or transfusion, and androgens if there is hypogonadism. And there may also be some palliative approach like using steroids or psychostimulants, and especially if it is a terminal illness. Okay. Similarly, there are for weight loss, for pain, and neuropathy. Okay, so neuropathy is very, very common in these patients. It may be because of the disease or maybe because of the treatment. So as I said, because now these patients, they live for many, many years with the disease and they take these medications, there are chances that these patients will develop the neurotoxicity because of because of the treatment also. So they usually have the stocking glove neuropathy, and those tingling sensation or burning sensation they develop. So the treatment, you can start on antineuropathic medications, usually gabapentin or duloxetine is recommended for neuropathic pain in these patients. What are the challenges in these patients? Usually these patients, they do not report, or many times we do not diagnose them. We are more concerned about the CD4 counts of these patients, or maybe some other symptoms, the weight of patients or the CBC and all. But we do not really address the pain in these patients. Many times there is history, or we are fear that these patients may develop drug abuse. And a lot of time there are polypharmacy, and we do not want drug interactions. So we are not able to give those medications that we will see here. So a lot of those HIV medications, maybe either it may be P450 inhibitor, and some may be P450 inducer. And you know, a lot of medications that are used in palliative care are metabolized through cytochrome P450. So it may be opioids, it may be some of the anti-emetics or anxiolytics. So we need to be careful when, and we need to know about those drugs that may induce or inhibit cytochrome 450. Other thing comes is when to stop ART. So there are a lot of guidelines about starting ART, but there is no guidelines to when to stop ART. Most of the time, recommendations are to continue ART as long as possible. But sometimes if patient is not very compliant or is not able to take the medications, and if we know that this patient is terminally ill at that time, we can stop ART also. So this was about CKD and HIV, and I think we have 10 more minutes. We can discuss about palliative care in neurological diseases. So neurological diseases, there are different kind of neurological diseases that may be those which has a short onset and limited life expectancy. So those patients who have serious brain injury, severe stroke, or very aggressive neoplasm that is growing very fast. So these patients, it's more like advanced cancer. So they have a short onset and very limited life expectancy, and they will need a good end of life care in these patients, good palliative care. But in the other side, there may also be those degenerative diseases which progresses over the time, and these patients live for very long time. So like the patients with irreversible dementia, neuromuscular diseases, patients with Parkinsonism, Alzheimer's, severe movement disorders, or multiple sclerosis. So these patients, they live longer, and because they live longer, there may be increased symptoms also in these patients. So what are the common symptoms? There may be pain, they may feel difficult in movement, or maybe there may be cognitive impairment or some psychobehavioral disorders, very common in Parkinsonism and dementia. There may be sensory deficits also. Sometimes they cannot feel on some part of the body, and that may lead to pressure ulcerations or many times burn or injury that can cause. Patients with dementia, they may develop dysphagia or many times aspiration that may lead to chronic dyspnea or other infections that can cause dyspnea. Seizures or drooling of saliva is very common. Over the time, if they are not able to move the limbs, they may develop rigidity, spasticity, or postural instability, and some abnormal movement. Many times, because if it is involving the brain, there may be delirium, and that may present as agitation and maybe some sleep and disturbances. And these patients also get psychological, psychosocial issues, because they cannot communicate. Many times they are unable to communicate with the people. And that may lead more distress among the family members, carers, and because it's a chronic thing, that it lead to socioeconomic issues also. There is a very common issue with these patients will require our team approach. We require physiotherapists, we require occupational therapists, we require a good psychologist to identify if there is any psychological issues, if there is any depression or delirium in these patients. Okay, so that's why it may be more we need a team approach. Okay. What is the impact of neurological diseases in for the patients? There is increased mortality. There are more behavioral complications in neurological diseases than any other disease. There are safety issues for the patients and loss of identity, and they are more dependent on others, maybe because they cannot walk or they cannot do their activities or daily living. In caregivers, because these patients have prolonged illness, it may lead to more distress, and it has found that these patients had and depression because of poor resilience and continuous distress.
Fungus, sir?
I'm sorry?
Sir, can you share the PPT, sir? Presentation?
Okay. So this we were talking about the impact of neurological diseases. So what we need to do, one is we need to provide the good symptom control in these patients. Other things we need to discuss for goals of care and advanced care planning in these patients. What if this patients develop some acute illness over the time, and this, would you like to go to the intensive care, or would you prefer for the comfort care? Who will give the care if the patient is at home? Whom to call? To identify the nearest doctors, these all things, and some home care for these patients. Okay, I think we'll skip this thing. If you want to read more about palliative care in chronic neurological illnesses, then there is again a good article on that was given by EAPC. So that you can read more about neurological illness. If you see commonly neurological diseases patients, it is important to know more about palliative care and neurology. Then in short, I think there is a separate topic on respiratory distress respiratory symptoms, and where we talk about respiratory illness also. In very short, I will tell about the patients who are with end-stage COPD or interstitial lung diseases. They need palliative care because they have chronic symptoms of cough or breathlessness, and that we have seen that it may improve with palliative care interventions. So these were some of the indicators specific to lung diseases. If we see for the COPD, there is management. One is correcting the correctable, so there may be some bronchodilators or anticholinergics, oxygen if there is hypoxemia. So first is pharmacological treatment. Then if pharmacological treatment doesn't work, then we can go for non-pharmacological treatment that involves some of the exercise, teaching them about the chest wall vibrations, some pulsed lift breathing techniques, keeping some fan in front of on the face so that their breathlessness can be reduced. But in those patients where pharmacological and both non-pharmacological therapies are not working, in that patients, we need to start some opioid therapy also. So there is very good evidence on role of opioids in chronic dyspnea. And that can be used in patients with COPD. So at the end, before I finish, so whenever I see a patient who has incurable illness, we need to ask ourselves, how can I use my professional skills and knowledge to reduce the suffering? Because these patients suffer for very, very long period of time, and that can impact very adversely to the patients and also for the family members. So that is our main aim in these patients. We need to be have a compassionate presence for these patients who have chronic suffering. And what am I learning about myself when I listen to someone who is suffering? So how I am growing over the time. Okay, so thank you so much for your patience listening. If there are any questions, we can take questions. We have almost 10 more minutes.
Thank you. If anybody has any question regarding non-cancer palliative care, please ask now. So this has been a broad subject, and he has done it with minimal information, but if you want to
as sir was telling, I had given a very brief overview about these illness, but there are good literature that I can share with you about learning more about each diseases. So especially for CKD, for motor neuron diseases, for dementia patients, for Parkinson's disorders, there are some small papers that you can read about if you are interested in palliative care and non-oncology. And I'm sure that the burden is quite high among these patients, non-oncological patients, but we see only the cancer, so we don't know about the need. Anyone who had some experience of seeing a patient who had palliative care need, who had great suffering, but you think you can give better care after doing this course?
Dr. Pankaj, it was a very nice presentation. And what you have said is we should use our skill to minimize the suffering of the patients. That's very good. What I have to say is every elderly patient above the age of 75, you can say even 80, needs a palliative care, even if he has not got any chronic disease. What do you say about that?
Thank you, sir. I agree with your point. The elderly have their needs, their own needs, and the disease, the treatment, the effect of treatment in this disease, and the course of disease is different in these patients, especially if they are frail. So, be difficult to give specialist palliative care for these people, but everyone, every physician, every nurse should have the should know the general principle of palliative care, what how we can give a better care for these patients in treatment, keeping those patients in ICUs, keeping those patients in on ventilator, and good communications. We should know how to communicate with the elderly, and we should know how to communicate the prognosis about the patients to the family members. The some approaches of palliative care, if we apply with our own practice we are doing, I think that is definitely needed. Yes, sir.
What you have to say about the high-tech torture of patients being done in ICUs nowadays?
Yes, sir. We see, unfortunately, we see a lot, especially in these patients, especially in elderly people, because I think you might have attended the first lecture by Dr. Raj Gopal. Whenever I have heard him, he always put that slide on his first page, where he talks about the torture that he undergoes in ICUs. And unfortunately, that is happening everywhere. Children wants to give all the treatment to their father or grandfather, but they do not understand, or they have not been explained properly about the prognosis, what may be the outcomes, and they may not have been given the option of comfort care. So it's a very valid point, sir, and we see a lot of time that the patients unnecessarily goes through those futile treatment and the torture, in short.
If you have any doubts regarding renal palliative care, please ask, because Pankaj leads a renal palliative care unit at KMC.
When we give the option of... Hello, Pankaj, Dr. Pankaj.
Yes, yes, sir.
When we give the option of stopping dialysis, how do patients react if they generally react?
Okay, yeah. So it's a very good question and very common thing also. First of all, I will tell it is difficult to stop the dialysis. Okay, so to withdraw from the dialysis. But it depends on the patient's conditions and your nephrologist also, what your nephrologist is telling the patient, because commonly these patients are on the follow-up for years with the nephrologist, and they have more trust on them. Okay, so if your nephrologist tells them that your patient is not doing well, and I think the dialysis is giving more trouble for the patients or it is increasingly become a burden for the patient, then sometimes the family members, they take it positively. But again, if nephrologist tells, because it is very common, that if you stop dialysis, the patients will die. Well, many times they hear this thing also, because the patients will develop uremia and blah blah, those complications are there. Then it becomes very difficult. From patients' perspectives or family members' perspectives, it depends from patients to patients. Some patients they really don't want dialysis, to continue dialysis, especially if they see a lot of their symptoms are increasing day by day, and if they are terminally ill. So we had seen a lot of patients who had stopped, but they were usually in very last stage of their life.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Yeah.
I want to know, is drooling a very common problem? Drooling.
Drooling of saliva, is it?
Yes. Yes,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah. So it is very commonly seen in patients who have neurological disease, specifically if it is stroke, in patients of motor neuron diseases, in patients of even advanced dementia also. It is seen of those patients who cannot deglutinate the saliva, those patients, or if they don't have power, or if there is facial asymmetries, it is very common problem.
So how do you treat fungus at drooling?
Sorry, I can't hear you, sir.
So what would you do in drooling patients to reduce that drooling?
Okay. So for reducing the drooling of saliva, one is proper position. Okay, so you can adjust the position of the patients, maybe some propped up position. Sometimes it helps. Sometimes on lateral position on the opposite side, if it is one-sided weakness that is causing drooling. One thing we need to assess, if patient is able to swallow or not. Okay, so if it is excessive salivation, if it is there, then we can give some medications to reduce excessive saliva. Okay, but we need to be aware that may cause more of the dryness of the mouth. Okay, so mainly the position is important in these patients. And sometime if a patient has very excessive salivation, a gentle suction may also help, although it is not very much recommended. Anything that you would like to add, sir? Sunil, sir?
As you told, medications sometimes cause dryness, but some patients would need that because of excessive drooling. So in such situation, some tricyclic antidepressants like amitriptyline or anticholinergics like glycopyrrolate can be used.
Hello, sir. I just want to ask you one more question.
Yes, sir. Please.
You say that drooling is related to severity of the dementia or any relation like that?
Usually it is in severe dementia, it can be when the patient is not able to swallow the things. Okay. So it depends on that thing. If patient is not able to swallow or may not be able to close the mouth, that time the drooling may be more.
But in spite of giving so much of medication, won't it have an impact on the saliva flow? And then how can drooling be seen so common?
You are asking that even after starting medications to reduce the excessive salivation, if still the excessive saliva or drooling of saliva persists, then what can we do? Okay, so one thing is like we can do the positioning. What we want, we do not want patient to aspirate, one thing, and other thing is it should not be very very disturbing for the patients, that drooling of saliva, it should not be very disturbing for the patient. So position, change in position over the time, so there should not be any accumulation of saliva, and again it should not come out again. So they change position from one lap lateral side to other lateral side, some propped up position, or keeping some pad also, or gentle suction, as I said, the gentle suction you can do, not very aggressively doing suction. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay. So I think we will move on to patient story, which will be presented by Dr. Kevin. So, Dr. Kevin.
Yeah, screen share.
Kevin, sir?
Now
you can share your screen, sir.
Good afternoon, Dr. Sunil, Dr. Pankaj, and all of the participants of this session of palliative care. I am Dr. Kevin. Today's patient story is regarding a 26-year-old male admitted to our hospital post a road traffic accident. He was head injured and he was operated. He has developed a close fracture dislocation of the fourth and fifth cervical vertebra with spinal cord injury and consequent quadriplegia, and his status is now post-tracheostomy. His persisting complaints are the anxiety and the feeling of helplessness due to the inability to move his limbs and a sacral bed sore. Plus, he has poor appetite, constipation, and dizziness on change of position. History of illness. He was admitted as history of alleged road traffic accident. He was hit by a speeding car while crossing the expressway in July 2020. Although he was conscious on arrival, he was later on intubated in the emergency department because of drop of the GCS. He was quadriplegic on arrival, and CT trauma had revealed a fourth and fifth cervical fracture dislocation with spinal cord compromise and a right frontotemporal EDH and a thin rim of SDH. The first was negative on presentation in the emergency department. Immediately was taken to the operation theater for a craniotomy with EDH evacuation or general anesthesia. Post surgery, he was taken to the ICU, where weaning attempts had failed multiple times due to his neurological status and the repeated episodes of lung collapse and chest infection. Finally, a tracheostomy was done by around second week, and he was successfully weaned off the ventilator by the 2nd of November, 2020. Now he is admitted to the ward. The tracheostomy has been closed. First, he had developed a foul-smelling sacral bed sore. He still has got grade 2 power in the right upper limb. On examination, the patient is fully conscious, oriented, obeying to command, has got a coherent speech, at times feels anxious. He gives a feeling of helplessness and being depressed. He's emaciated with muscle wasting and stiffness of its right shoulder. Vitals are stable on room air. He is afebrile. There's no pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, or lymphadenopathy. His hydration status is okay. All systems are fine. On further examination of the systems, he has got a power of 2/5 in the right upper limb. But for all the other limbs, his power is grade 0/5. The reflexes and the tone are absent. Visual analog score is 3/10. Abdomen is soft to palpation and non-tender. He has got no guarding or rigidity. He has also a grade 4 sacral bed sore, which is the healing stage. Treatment significant investigation. His current hemoglobin is 10.2, which is quite satisfactory, but he has been transfused one or two times in the ICU because of anemia. Lab values are unremarkable except that of being having hyperalbuminemia, a high CRP, but a normal procalcitonin. He had developed sepsis, which is not resolved because of the right upper lung collapse consolidation and the right pneumothorax, for which he required bronchoscopy, repeated bronchoscopies, an ICD, and further ventilator managements. At times, he's constipated. He needs glycine suppository and phosphate enema. He complains of having a right shoulder stiffness in spite of the limb and the chest physiotherapy. He can sit up in the bed and even can be, he can mobilize on the wheelchair with assistance. In the ward, in spite of frequent change of position and being on an air mattress, he has developed a grade 4 sacral bed sore with undermined edges. This is being taken care of by the wound management team and the plastic surgeon, who have debrided the wound with removal of the slough, daily dressings, and the sore is in the healing stage now. The culture of the sputum and the wound had revealed a multi-drug resistant organism, and the sepsis has now resolved. Currently, he's not on any antibiotics and all his cultures are negative. Focusing on the psychosocial aspects, I had interviewed him personally, and this is about my findings. He's educated, he has completed his polytechnic and he works as an electrician. He's married since 5 years, has no children, has one sister staying with his old parents. He's a sole breadwinner of the family, and that's why he feels depressed, as there are no relatives here in his country and he cannot send money back home. And he feels miserable about his flaccid limb. This may add to his social pain. He hopes to regain muscle power and return to work someday, but at times he's too negative about this is an illness. His night sleep is at times disturbed with negative thoughts about the future. He reads the Bible, he prays and listens to music for spiritual rejuvenation. Efforts are being on to repatriate him to his home country, through his country's embassy as soon as possible. His pain medications include an IV paracetamol round the clock and ibuprofen. Local application of indomethacin spray and ketoprofen topical gel. He's on anticoagulants, enoxaparin, tabrapiprazole. For his complaints of constipation, he's on glycerin and at times phosphate enema. His pain score was taken as 3/10, but at times it reaches 6/10 because of non-specific aches and pains of the limb. And this will disturb his sleeps at night and gives him negative thoughts. He's also on some sedatives quite infrequently. The main concerns about this patient are that he's feeling hopeless and he has fear of not regaining his muscle power and being dependent on others throughout his life. This social pain adds to his psychological and the spiritual pain. Another issue is with the healing, but a very bad sacral bed sore. He has frequent complaints of dizziness on change of position and a poor appetite and constipation. To summarize, my patient is 26-year-old male, post a road traffic accident, who had a head injury which was operated, has main issue as a cervical spine with a fracture dislocation with spinal cord injury, quadriplegic and bed sore, complaints of poor appetite, constipation, physical pain, which are non-specific aches and pain, and the social pain due to not having any caregivers with him now, and some financial issues of the family. The psychological pain arises because of the feeling of a helplessness and hopelessness due to flaccid weakness of the limbs, and the spiritual pain due to the disturbed night sleep and the negative thoughts about his future. Thank you, sir. Let's go to discussion points. Over to you, Sunil, sir.
We have a young man who is married with no children and is now quadriparous he is not in his home country. The discussion points. So what is COTI and how is it treated in the community? Is there any other method of catheterization that suits this patient? At times, patient complains of sleepiness. What are the treatment options? So this is a very common situation, especially in our country. because people fall down from trees or buildings, and they may become paraplegic or quadriplegic. And road traffic accidents are another problem for paraplegia or quadriplegia. One of the common problems. So anybody can comment on this because all of you have seen patients on catheter. So what is for you? And how is it treated in the community?
Most of the patients who are quadriplegics do require Foley's catheter, and they simultaneously develop catheterosis urinary tract infection. I would like to highlight that my present patient, he uses a condom catheter for passing urine. CORTI is actually a diagnosis of exclusion. You cannot just say that because the patient is having a bacteria in his urine and he's having a CORTI. So this is as per the some definition by IDSA, that the definition of CORTI is that patient having signs and symptoms of urinary tract infection within less than 48 hours of catheterization or removal of the catheter. And we have to exclude all other causes for any infection other than the urinary infection. And the lab criteria would be to find more than 1,000 colony forming units of this organism in the urine. This is very important because even elderly people, most of them, they have bacteria in the urine. And this doesn't amount to a catheter-associated urinary tract infection. Regarding other modes of catheterization, my suggestion is
Kevin, can you wait? Let's take opinion from others. Anybody else?
Self-catheterization could be done in females especially, but I don't think this patient has got paralysis, so it will be possible of the upper limb.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because he has only grade 2 power on right upper limb, and left upper limb is grade 0. Yeah, you are correct, madam. So self-intermittent clean catheterization, which is usually done, will not be possible in this patient.
Can you use a condom catheter like this patient?
We have to assess the post-voital urine volume, residual urine volume. Then only we can decide what type of catheterization we need. Because if there is significant amount of post-voital urine, then he is not a suitable patient for condom catheter. He need to be either Foley's catheter in situ, or need to have intermittent catheterization by somebody else. Or another option is maybe suprapubic catheter. We have to first measure the post-voital urine by ultrasound and then decide. Do you know whether this patient has had an ultrasound to detect post-voital urine volume?
No, actually, because I'm not part of the treating team.
Okay. Urinary tract infection is very common, and many of the patients, they are in the will be at their home, and it will be very difficult for the family to transfer the patient to a hospital for each and everything. And we see many patients in the community. So when we see the patients in the community, it will not be like in a hospital. We only have minimal resources. So we have to, but at the same time, we have to treat the patient. So in the community, how will you diagnose a urinary tract infection?
Fever with chills?
Yeah, fever with chills. Anything else?
The lab criteria applies the pustules in the urine.
Yeah, but it might be difficult. Even though we can order a culture, but still it will be difficult. And some literature says, as you told, the important thing is any COTI. COTI is a diagnosis by exclusion. So you have to first rule out the possibilities of infection from other parts of the body.
Yeah.
And then if the patient has any fever, lower abdominal pain, or loin pain, and sudden deterioration of general condition, or sudden appearance of delirium, all these are indicative of UTI. In a patient who is 35. So it may not be always possible for you to do urine routine and culture and then start on antibiotics. So one thing is that if you test the urine of a patient who is chronically 35, then the urine sample is going to be always positive for person. So this is mostly asymptomatic bacteriuria. And for asymptomatic bacteriuria, the colony count should be more than 1 lakh per cubic millimeter. Yeah. So a patient with symptoms of urinary tract infection in the community, like a fever with chills, sudden deterioration of general condition, lower abdominal pain, loin pain, delirium, new onset delirium, etc., should be taken as UTI, catheter-associated urinary tract infection. I thought Pankaj left, but I see Pankaj is here. Pankaj, are you here?
Yes, sir. I was here.
Pankaj, do you have anything to contribute to COTI and how it can be treated in community?
Yeah, so in palliative care, we see this as a very important, very recurrent problem. Okay, so once the diagnosis of COTI, first thing is we need to avoid these infections. We need to counsel them how to take care of or how to prevent infection, catheter-associated infection. Okay. So one thing, we usually advise them to go for silicone-based catheter if we are thinking that patient will need long-term catheterization. We need to strictly follow those aseptic precautions when we are inserting the catheter, changing urine bag more frequently, and seeing for any infection if there are any signs of infection. Usually, as we are practicing in hospital, so we go by the culture. So about the antibiotic protocol. So for first thing, if it is diagnosed with COTI, then we need to change the antibiotic, change the catheter, and go for antibiotic as per the culture and sensitivity report. So by the culture and sensitivity report. one very important thing is we need to continue treatment as per the antibiotics, that we need to complete the treatment. Many times, once they are asymptomatic, they stop coming to the for taking injections or tablets. They do not complete the antibiotic schedule, and that leads to resistance of the bacteria. Other important thing in palliative care is we need to address the symptoms. So antibiotics may take some time to resolve that symptom of burning, menstruation or burning in that part. So giving some medications to reduce the burning, maybe pyridium or maybe alkalizers, that may reduce the burning sensation, or sometimes the antispasmodics, urinary antispasmodics. So that is what we practice here.
Yeah, one of the important things is that we should educate the patient and family regarding how to take care of the catheter if there is an indwelling or indwelling polish catheter, or if the patient is doing plain intermittent catheter. So some of the things are you have to ask the patient to
watch sir, the, sir?
Yeah.
We can hear you, sir.
Okay. How is now?
Yes.
Okay. So I was talking about educating the patient and family regarding the catheter care. So after a passing motion or whenever it is soiled, we have to ask the patient to clean the catheter with soap and water. And another common thing is the urinary bag is usually kept on the same bed, but it should be at a lower level compared to the catheter. Otherwise, the urine will go back, which will cause infection. So that's one thing. And should ask the patient to or caregiver to empty the urine bag frequently. Don't wait to become it too full. And another practice is that some patients they remove the urinary bag from the catheter and they frequently do it. What we have to understand is urinary catheter and bag is a closed system. Once catheterized, as far as possible, we should not remove the urinary bag from the catheter. Because each time when you remove, the chance of introducing infection is more common. So these are something which we have to be careful. We talked about other methods of catheterization. At times, patient is complains of sleeplessness. So what are the treatment options? Anybody? So sleeplessness is a very common problem, which we see not only in palliative care patients, but also in any other type of patients. So what would you do in such situation?
Give tricyclics.
Pharmacological and non-pharmacological approaches, both are required.
Yeah, Dr. Kevin.
We should rely on both the pharmacological and non-pharmacological. Like for this patient in particular, he gets visits from a counselor or a social worker. who caters to his psychological. The cause of his sleeplessness is his thought. And when I was interviewing him, at times he seems positive and at times he seems very negative about his future because of his quadriplegia. So we have to counsel the patient, assure him, other than being going for pharmacological treatment like zolpidem or any, we should limit the sedatives at all frequent.
Pankaj, do you want to comment on this?
So as you told, sir, it is very common. And especially in these patients who are bed bound for very long term, these patients have these problems very commonly. Other issue that Dr. Kevin has pointed out that he had anxiety. He had a lot of anxiety related to social issues, financial things, and because of his disease itself. So that may lead to the sleeplessness. But the challenges comes how to address these things. So one is addressing the anxiety, good psychological support, good counseling may be needed. And with that, arranging like how we can mitigate those anxiety issues. Second thing is giving good sleep hygiene because it may be challenging in these kind of patients. Okay, so maybe we can give passive exercises for these patients. If the patients can be brought out in the sunlight, on in a garden, on wheelchair, or maybe on the sofa for some time, and especially during the daytime. Some advice that for sleep in the night, he should go to another bed if it is possible. That is only meant for his sleep, and he should not lie down for rest of this time during the daytime. If it is possible, it should not be an added burden for the people, but it may be advised that during the daytime he can be on sofa or on the wheelchair and can be at around. Some passive physiotherapies can be done and some massage during the evening time. That is usually non-pharmacological measures. So that is about the sleep hygiene. Benzodiazepines can be advised, but I usually do not recommend benzodiazepines, especially if it is head trauma. But as you said, this case, this patient had head trauma long back. So that was not a problem. You can start with a smaller dose of anxiolytic benzodiazepine. So maybe some clonazepam. You can start a very small dose, 0.125 mg. And if he is not able to sleep at all, you can continue for some time. Only problem is if you continue for longer term, the dependence on benzodiazepines may increase, and that may itself can be an issue. So better to start with sleep hygiene and a good counseling, and that may reduce his anxiety. And I really want to congratulate Dr. Kevin. It was a very good case presentation, and it's a very common issue in road traffic accident. Here also we see a lot of young patients coming with quadriplegia post accident, and these are the common issues what you pointed out.
I completely agree with Pankaj. So whenever you see some patients having sleep problem, it should not be equivalent to writing benzodiazepines, because sleep can be disturbed due to many other factors. It can be physical problems, it can be psychological problems. In this patient is young, he is married, and he is bedbound, and he is unable to move. You also told that he is hopeless. So I think we need to assess him for other features of depression. Then environment itself is a problem. Whenever we are in some unfamiliar environment, then that itself can cause decreased sleep. If he is in a hospital, the nurses will come and give the medication as per the duty schedule, and the sleep can get disturbed in many ways. So there are many factors which can affect the sleep. So it is important for us to determine what exactly are the problems that cause a sleep disturbance. And then as we told, Pankaj talked about the sleep hygiene, which is very important. So you can search it in the net, American Sleep Association sleep hygiene. So there are, I think, 10 or 12 points in the sleep hygiene, which can be practiced, and correcting the environment and reducing the time in the bed, avoiding watching TV or television during, when at least 1 hour before going to bed. So there are many things in the sleep hygiene. If non-pharmacological management does not help, sometimes you need to start pharmacological management along with non-pharmacological management when the patient is greatly disturbed. So in this patient, I'm not sure, but still whether an antidepressant might help this patient, acetylopram or citalopram, something. I think he need to be seen by, if he's seen by a psychologist, and if she thinks that need to be seen by a psychiatrist, it would be good to assess for depression. Anybody else has any more comments?
How to boost?
Sorry. We didn't hear.
These patients.
Sorry, how to?
Boost the morale.
Okay. So this is, the problem is that he is a very young patient. And we have a halfway home here where we admit patients with paraplegia or quadriplegia, and try to make them as independent as possible. So when they see patients like them, and if any of them have achieved anything in their life, then that will be a great model for them to see. And when they talk to other members, that will also help them to go forward. Then they will understand, okay, that person was also in my position, but he is going forward. How he is going forward, what all he has done, all this will be a great boost for this patient. So paraplegia or quadriplegia support group. And many of them get connected through WhatsApp groups, and this will also help them to go forward. So these are the two things which I have seen. Many patients, they take messages from others regarding.
Thank you.
Pankaj, shall I wind up the session? Kevin?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Pankaj, for being with us, and you have demonstrated why palliative care is important in non-cancer illness, and how and when palliative care has to be given for each group of patients. So thank you, Pankaj, and Thank you, Dr. Kevin. This was a very relevant patient story because it has demonstrated all the suffering in non-cancer patients are more or equal to the that of a cancer patient. Thank you for a very good patient story, and thank you all for your interactions, and we'll see you on